Merci beaucoup d'être venu. Je vais parler sur mon nouveau sujet de recherche, Property Exploitation and Control, les droits de propriété. Ce projet est un cours très exploratoire et tous vos commentaires sont vraiment bienvenus. So what I'll do is I'll defend three claims about the connection between property on the one hand and exploitation and control on the other. I'll argue that there is a systematic connection between these, so that property can systematically generate exploitation and control. I'll furthermore argue that this systematic connection is what actually makes property a topic for political philosophy in the first place. And I'll argue that in order to adequately describe that fact, any theory of private property will need the category of means of production. So those are my three claims. And I'm going to proceed as follows. I'll first begin by presenting three influential theories of private property. Locke's, who argues that property is a natural right. David Hume's, who argues the opposite, that property is just a useful social convention. And then Kant, who thinks that property is a metaphysical prerequisite for rational agency. All of these three theories, I'm going to argue, are unable to capture this link between property on the one hand and exploitation and control on the other. And the reason for that, I'll argue, is that they all work with a single category of private property. And I'll call that category personal belongings. Now, in the 19th century, we have the development of theories that do a much better job at describing this systematic connection, and I think the reason why they do a better job is that they distinguish between these different types of property, and because this connection to exploitation and control, I'm going to argue, only exists for some types of property. So these are multiple category theories. I think a plausible theory of private property will need to make at least the distinction between means of consumption and means of production. Historically, there has been almost no movement that has opposed private property means of consumption. It's always private property means of production that has been controversial, and as I'll argue, that is for good reason. So, and therefore, when we discuss questions such as whether there should be patents on medical inventions, or whether we should privatize the municipal water supply, or whether there should be a tax on inheritance, we really need to distinguish these two kinds of property, because otherwise we do miss the point of sensible disagreement. So that is my plan for today. I originally planned to also talk about an objection which you might have seen on the CRÉ website if you read the abstract of this presentation. I hope you didn't come specifically for that part, although if you did, we can of course talk about it in Q&A. The objection that people sometimes make to making means of production a major feature of property theories is that, well, that might have been a very useful feature back in the 19th century when people still ran the enterprise that they owned. But today the largest companies are joint stock companies, and here ownership and control fall apart because we have the shareholders who own, and then we have the managerial class that controls. And I think there's a very useful objection to be found in Hilferding, this book, Finance Capital, from 1910, to be made against that. And yeah, I'll skip that in the presentation, but we can certainly talk about that if you're interested in that. So I'll start with Locke, and most of you will be very familiar with this. So Locke says, though the earth be common to all men, yet every man has property in his own person. The labor of his body and the work of his hands, as we may say, are properly his. Whatsoever he then removes out of the state that nature has provided and left it in, he has mixed his labor with and joined to something that already is his own, and thereby makes it his property. So the idea is originally everything is owned in common, with the only exception of human beings. We all own ourselves. And we can now turn objects from this common stock into private property by mixing them with something that is already owned privately. Importantly, labor is just one example here, so I'm sure most of you all know this. It's just sometimes people misunderstand that and think what Locke is talking about is really desert or improving the object in question or something like that. But the following passage shows that that would be a misunderstanding. Locke says, "Thus the grass my horse has bit, the turfs my servant has cut, and the ore that I have digged in any place where I have a right to them in common with others become my property." So it's not just your personal labor that counts, it's also the activity of your servants or the activity of your cattle, which can only, not even metaphorically, be called work, of course. And so the fact that the whole process has to start with work is just coincidental. It's just owed to the fact that the only thing that is originally owned privately is work. Hume reverses this whole construction. He says, the principal disturbance in society arises from those goods which we call external and from their looseness and easy transition from one person to another. So in order to be able to live together, human beings must seek a remedy. This can be done after no other manner than by a convention entered into by all the members of the society to bestow stability on the possessions of those external goods and leave everyone in the peaceable enjoyment of what he may acquire by his fortune and industry. By this means, everyone knows what he may safely possess, and the passions are restrained in their partial and contradictory emotions. It is by that means that we maintain society. So for Hume, property is this very pragmatic social arrangement. It's advantageous for human beings to live in groups, and in order to have the necessary peace among the members of the group, you will need all of these members to subscribe to the same rules regulating material entitlements. That's the idea. Kant turns this whole construction upside down again. So for Hume, human beings must give themselves property rights in order to be able to even live together as a group. For Kant, property rights are the reason why we must found a community in the first place. And there cannot be property rights in the state of nature, Kant thinks. And he also thinks that human beings are required to live in the state of nature precisely because they are required to acquire property rights. And now, why does he think that? Well, for Kant, there could be no outer freedom without property. He says, it is possible for me to have any external object of my choice as mine. That is the maxim by which, if it were to become a law, an object of choice would in itself have to belong to no one, is contrary to rights. For an object of my choice is something that I have the physical power to use. If it were nevertheless absolutely not within my rightful power to make use of it, that is, if the use of it could not coexist with the freedom of everyone in accordance with the universal law, then freedom would be depriving itself of the use of its choice with regard to an object of choice, even though in the use of things, choice was formally consistent with everyone's outer freedom in accordance with universal laws. Now, the way that passage is usually interpreted is this. Secure title in things is prerequisite to the capacity to use an object and to pursue ends. Now, if you wonder how to get from here to here, to more, you don't know, there's a lot of exegetical disagreement how exactly to read Kant here. Some people think this really contains two arguments wrapped up in one. Some people think it's an incomplete argument. I suggest that we reconstruct the argument as follows. Assume that for a given object O, it would be illegitimate for anyone to use it because usage of O could not coexist with Kantian moral standards. Then we could never make use of our outer freedom with respect to that object. And if all objects were like that object, there would in practice be no outer freedom at all. And therefore, at least some objects must be unlike O. So at least some objects must, for some objects, it must be possible to use them in accordance with everyone's freedom, universal law, and so forth. And therefore, it must be possible to own objects. Now, here's the second occasion for justified puzzlement, namely, how do we get from I have to be able to use to I have to be able to own? It does seem to make sense that in order to be able to act in the world at all, you need to be allowed to manipulate physical objects and so forth. But why do you need to own them? The literature makes different suggestions here again. Some people think, well, Kant might be thinking that many goods are scarce, so if it might be that me using something excludes you from using that, something along these lines. I think that Kant could simply be making a conceptual claim here, namely that if you have certain usage rights with respect to certain objects, you de facto own these objects. Let me expand on that point a little, because it'll become important for my own argument later on. There was a really interesting debate about property and polity in the mid-13th to mid-14th century between the Dominicans and the newly founded Franciscan order, where this metaphysical point came up. So the Dominicans are already a mendicant order, but the Franciscans aspire to be even poorer. The Dominicans are not allowed to own anything in person, but St. Francis required his followers to even not have anything in common either. So the Franciscans aspire to have no possessions whatsoever, neither as individuals nor in common. Now the reality did look quite a bit different. The Franciscans were a very popular order, received many donations, grew very quickly very rich and powerful, and their adversaries pointed out, well, you have lands, you have servants, you have libraries, you travel in diplomatic missions, you are really anything but poor. The Franciscans, however, had a lot of clever philosophers among their ranks, so people like William Faulkner were done scholars, who came up with a very clever justification to bridge that gap between ideology and reality. And they argued that in reality, all of the possessions of the Franciscan order were just owned by the Pope, whereas the order only retained something that they called simplex usus facti, which we might translate as simple actual use. An example that the Franciscans often used in philosophical debates was, we stand to our possessions as a horse stands to its hay. The horse consumes the hay, but it doesn't own it. The hay is owned by the horse's master. And similarly, we, as an order, we use all of these things, but actually we don't own them, they're owned by the Pope. I think today we call that a straw man construction. Now this made the Dominicans very angry, of course, and I think 1328, Hervé de Nériac wrote a pamphlet against this stance on the poverty of Christ and the apostles, in which he argued as follows. If human beings have certain permissions with respect to certain objects, then they in fact own these objects. If they, for instance, have the permission to fully consume the object without asking anybody for consent, something like that. De Nériac thought that that was a larger metaphysical point, namely that absolute poverty is impossible for rational beings. And that is also, I think, what Kant might be thinking when he says that human beings need poverty in at least some objects in order to be able to exercise their freedom. So that's Locke, Hume, and Kant. Now, when you read these three philosophers, you might start wondering why private property should be such a controversial topic in the first place. We've got this huge debate in political philosophy about distributive justice, right? And then we have all of these actual political disagreements about property. And we even have parties whose founding main point is the abolishment of certain types of property. Now, why would that be the case? From the writings of Locke, Hume, and Kant, I think it's really mysterious. What Hume says about property, for instance, could just as well be said about etiquette. We could just substitute the key terms as follows. The principal disturbance in society arises from those behaviors which we call impolite, and from their prevalence and easy transition from one person to another. In order to be able to live together, human beings must seek for a remedy, and this can be done after no other manner than by a convention entered into by all the members of the society to show respect towards others, and leave everyone in the peaceable pursuit of their own business. But this means everyone knows what he may safely expect, and the passions are restrained in their partial and contradictory emotions. It is by this means that we sustain society. Now, we're all familiar with political slogans such as property is theft, but there's no political slogan like etiquette is disrespect or something like this. I don't want to say that etiquette could never be a political topic at all. There's certainly political issues related to that, but it just isn't a political topic nearly on the same scale. There just isn't as much disagreement in literature and so forth about it. Something similar I think could be said with respect to Kant. So what Kant says about ownership in objects might just as well be said about health. If I injure you, then I also deprive you of your outer freedom just as much as if I would steal from you, for instance, probably more. And now Kant would of course agree that we shouldn't injure other people, but we should ask ourselves, why is property such a big topic for political philosophy and tort law isn't? Not, again, that physical injury is no topic for political philosophy at all, but just again, really not on the same scale. So what's different? Well, I think the feature of property that makes it a political topic is that it generates the social hierarchies, right? It systematically generates exploitation and control. And that is, I think, what does make the topic for political philosophy. Now, some of you might be more left-leaning and be on board with that anyway. For those who are more skeptical, let me try to support that diagnosis a little. We could imagine a culture where there's zero overlap between the people who own property and the people who own power. There's no logical contradiction in that. Empirically, however, the overlap is usually quite considerable. It is, in fact, so large that some anthropologists, like Donald Brown, for instance, have classified de facto oligarchy as a human universal. Now, this idea of human universals is controversial, some people don't believe in them, and perhaps Brown is mistaken, and not all societies show this, but the point is, quite a lot of them do, an awful lot, so that even if that shouldn't be true for 100% of all societies, if it's true for 90% or so, the point in question here would still hold. Something similar is also said by historians, for instance by Moses Finley in his influential book, The Ancient Economy. David Graeber in his book on Kant summarizes this book by Finley as follows. As the great classicist Moses Finley often liked to say, in the ancient world, our revolutionary movements had a single program, cancel the debts and redistribute the land, redistribute the means of production. In many cultures, we actually have an official link between property and control. So often, for instance, a certain amount of property is necessary in order to hold political office. And one such example is Imperial Rome, where you needed at least 1 million sesterces in order to become a senator. Now, 1 million was quite a lot at that point, and that would have put you among the 0.003% of richest households. So that is how much you need in order to be even eligible for a seat in the Senate. Now today things are a little more subtle, of course. The current US property distribution has the same shape as that of Imperial Rome. They both look like this. People sometimes call this the L curve because it's like the letter L inverted. Now, if it should be true that the richest 0.003% of households in the US exert a great deal of control, that would of course be much more complicated to show than it is for the Roman case, because this influence would by definition convert. So what an empirical investigator can hope to uncover in such cases are only, I think, individual pathways of influence, such as campaign finance, or property legislation, or lobbyism. So I don't think for such a society it is as easy to show the connection, but I think despite these methodological difficulties regarding these topics that I just mentioned, like lobbyism and so forth, there's quite a lot of data that supports the view that even today property and control are still very highly correlating variables, as they seem to be for most societies for most of history. Now, on the other end of the property distribution, the lower end, we of course get the inverse relation. A lack of property usually means a severe lack of control over your own life. Here's a description of that by Virginia Woolf, and that's really a key passage of A Room of One's Own. And in that passage, Woolf traces women's lack of freedom back to their lack of property, and she reports how an unexpected inheritance transforms her into a free person. She says, my aunt, Mary Batten, I must tell you, died by a fall from her horse when she was riding out to take the air in Bombay. The news of my legacy reached me one night about the same time that the act was passed that gave votes to women. A solicitor's letter fell into the postbox, and when I opened it, I found that she had left me £500 a year forever. Of the two, the vote and the money I owe seemed infinitely the more important. Before that, I had made my living by catching odd jobs from newspapers. I need not, I'm afraid, describe in any detail the hardness of the work, for you know perhaps women have done it, or the difficulty of living on the money when it was earned, for you may have tried. But what still remains with me as a worse infliction than either was the poison of fear and bitterness which those days bred in me. To begin with, always to be doing work that one did not wish to do it like a slave, flattering and falling. And not always necessary, perhaps, but it seemed necessary, and the stakes were just too great to run the risks. So, Wolf claims that her poverty caused her a lot of practical difficulties, but worse, she says, was the lack of control that it caused for her and the control that it gave others over her life, and the financial independence she gained through this inheritance was much, much more important for her quality of life than the right to political participation, which is no comparison between the two, she says. What Wolf describes here is a class experience, of course. And so she takes her past experience to be representative of the condition of women without property. And she also thinks that this experience was a systematic consequence of the fact that she was poor. Now, Wolf's experience and the conclusions that she draws from it were shared by many around the same time. In the opening pages of What is Property, Proudhon motivates his project as follows. In 1789, there was struggle in progress, a revolution that was known. An examination of the reforms which were attempted proves this. The more obnoxious forms of property, statute, labor, monument, maîtrise, and exclusion from public office have disappeared. The conditions of its enjoyment have been modified, but the principle still remains the same. There has been progress in the regulation of the right property right, but there has been no revolution. These then are the three fundamental principles of modern society established one after another by the movements of 1789 and 1830. Sovereignty of the human will, short despotism, inequality of wealth and rank, and property. So, Proudhon seems to think maybe the revolution did bring certain civil rights, but it failed to really liberate the masses from exploitation and it failed to give them control. In short, his diagnosis is that the revolution failed because it failed to give people property. I think it's really no exaggeration to say that this diagnosis is what gave birth to all of the political movements of the 19th century that came to be summarized under the heading of left-wing later on. So social democrats, communists, anarchists, and so forth. This idea that property relations didn't change, and therefore social hierarchies didn't change. In fact, the revolution didn't really change the things that really were at stake. Now, taking all of that together, the anthropological data and the historical data, these descriptions from the inside, of course, and this birth of the left from the diagnosis of the failed revolution, it does seem to be a reasonable assumption that property and control and exploitation do hang together. What I've said does not amount to a proof, of course, but there does seem to be strong evidence that those who have property can exercise a considerable amount of power, and those who lack property experience a lack of control and often also experience exploitation. Now, I've said that an adequate theory of private property would need to address this connection. And I argued earlier that Locke's and Hume's and Kant's theory failed to do that. Now, what is it that's missing? Why is it that they make property just look like any useful social arrangement? And what feature exactly is it that they lack? Well, I think they lack enough categories. So for Locke, Hume, and Kant, all property is of one kind. And I think we could call that kind personal belongings. By personal belongings, I mean personal means of consumption plus the very limited means of production that you would need to produce these. The two treatises, Locke's and Hume's treatise, are populated by people who cut turf and dig for ore and graze their cattle. Now, I don't know what comes out of your minds when you read such examples, but I imagine this. So, sort of frontier town.
Is that Canada?
No, that's South Dakota. It's supposed to be the wildest town of the Wild West at that point.
There's a great TV series called Deadwood.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I think what the type of society that these theories really fit is one is a small community whose members are economically independent. Farmers who mostly grow for their own consumption and a little bit of sale maybe, and then small business owners. So in other words, people who own their means of production and hence are their own boss. In such a society, no one controls or exploits the others, and therefore it is true what Hume says, that they all have an interest to peaceably enjoy what they acquire by their fortune industry. People in these idealized frontier towns, they will just reap what they sow with the industrious and the lucky a little more, the lazy and the shameless a little less, but really your destiny is in your own hands. Now, that I think is very different from an industrialist economy, where most people are the employees of others. And in fact, of course, it wasn't even true for the very hierarchical societies of Hume's and Locke's own time. Something analogous, I think, can be said for Kant. Yes, you do need to be allowed to use physical objects in order to exercise outer freedom. And maybe Deneda is right in that you need to own at least some of these objects in order to be able to do so. But I think that is worlds apart from the modern types of property that we actually disagree about, such as patents or credit default swaps, here's how they work if you ever wanted to know, or copyrights. Applying this idea of outer freedom to these kinds of property really strikes me as a category mistake, similar to that of applying the idea of free speech to a corporation. So, what we really need is a distinction between types of private property that are linked to exploitation and control and those that aren't. And I think in order to make that distinction, we need the category of means of production. And because that is the only category for which people have ever diagnosed a systematic link. Why should there be a link between this particular type of property and exploitation and control? Well, classical account is of course Marxist, who imagines this as this endless cycle of production and reproduction. So we've got human beings, they consume stuff like means of consumption, food and clothes and buildings and transportation and all the kind of stuff that we need. And then they reproduce themselves using this stuff. In particular, they reproduce their labor power. And that enables them to produce more means of consumption. This kind of existential cycle, of course, means that if you can control any of these links in the chain, this will clearly give you a great deal of power. And that is why Marx thinks that control over means of production really means control over people and also provides incentive to exploit them, of course. That is where the systematic connection is supposed to lie. The fiercest critic in the history of philosophy of private property is probably Proudhon, right? And this is the last long quotation that I'm going to bore you with. Proudhon imagines the development of inequality as follows. Agriculture was the foundation of territorial possession and the original cause of property. The husbandman needed each year a field to sow. What more convenient and simple arrangement for the barbarians? Instead of indulging in annual quarrels and fights, instead of continually moving their houses, their furniture, and families from spot to spot, then to assign to each individual a fixed and inalienable estate. But it was not right that the soldier returning from an expedition should find himself dispossessed on account of the services which he had just rendered to his country. His estate ought to be restored to him. It became, therefore, customary to retain property they intend alone. Those who made the corresponding laws, however, did not foresee that the perpetual absolute right to retain one's estate involves the right to transfer, sell, give, gain, and lose it. It attends, consequently, to nothing less than the destruction of that equality which they established it to maintain. They did not foresee, these ingenious legislators, that if property is retainable by intent alone, it carries with it the right to let, to lease, to loan at interest, to profit by exchange, to settle annuities, and to levy a tax on a field which intent reserves while the body is busy elsewhere. So the idea is it would be a hassle if people had to move around all year long, it would have all sorts of practical disadvantages, like it would incentivize spoilage and it would cause quarrels and so forth, and then people would have to leave temporarily, come back and have no means of subsistence anymore. And we can avoid all of that if we just assign one plot of land to the same person. In fact, that isn't just a pragmatic solution on Proudhon's account, it's actually something that secures equality. As long as we're concerned with an economy of self-subsistence farmers, so as long as we're concerned with a frontier town, the problem begins, Proudhon claims, once we move away from self-subsistence farming and treat land as a commodity. So before we have this perfect overlap between the land that he owned and the land that he used. Once we separate usage and ownership, it suddenly becomes possible to amass more land through sales and interest and so forth, much more than anybody could use for their own consumption. And that is what tends to create vast inequalities. So even Proudhon does not oppose personal belongings. And his stance is actually representative of critics of private property. It is very difficult to find a single historical example of a philosopher or a movement that has demanded the abolishment of property completely, that was opposed even to personal belongings. The reason why there have been so few advocates of absolute poverty are, I think, very obvious. One are these practical considerations that Proudhon mentions. You would have to move around all the time, you would never know in the morning when the toothbrush will be there and so forth. So there are these pragmatic things, and then there's the metaphysical problem that Galileo brings up, which is, it is a real question whether rational beings can truly have no property at all. So that means the philosophical disagreements about property have always concerned a particular type of property only. And this type of property is property in means of production, or more precisely, in means of production that vastly exceed the owner's personal need. And therefore, I think a theory of private property will need the category of means of production if it is to capture what is at stake in debates about property. A theory like Locke's and Hume's and Kant's that treats all kinds of property as of one kind really is not fine-grained enough to capture what is at stake in debates about property. So, conclusions. I argue that Locke's and Kant's theory failed to capture the systematic link between property, exploitation, and control. I said that they only see plausible for a society of authority individuals, that they operate with a single category of private property, and that that category is best understood as personal belongings, which are defined as goods for personal consumption, plus the limited means needed to produce these. And I also argued that only a certain kind of property has been systematically linked to exploitation and control, and is hence controversial at all. So no influential author has ever demanded the abolishment of personal belongings. Some, like Proudhon, even take personal belongings to advance equality. And so all criticism concerns private property in very large means of production. And therefore, a comprehensive theory of property, we need to distinguish at least these two kinds, personal belongings and large-scale means of production. Okay, thank you very much. Okay.